My name is Mei Lin and I live in Dublin. I lead a pretty normal life, just like everyone else. I get up in the morning and I go to work. I also go swimming, go to the gym, and listen to music. There are some aspects of my life that are not so ordinary, like the time I got to meet with Leo Varadkar, or the time that I went skydiving, or the many medals I have won representing Ireland. Oh, and by the way, I also have Down syndrome. This year is a big year for me. I recently started in a new job, and in December I will turn 30. The time has come for me to start thinking about my future, to start planning a way forward. But where do I start? Luckily for me, there is a group of researchers in Trinity College who for the past 10 years have been studying what it is like for people with intellectual disabilities to grow older in Ireland. Today, I'm meeting with Professor Mary McCarron to find out more about the study, and hopefully she will give me some tips that I can age in a healthy way, age in a happy way, age with pride. Hey, so tell me why IDS-TILDA was started.
Right, well, IDS-TILDA was started over 10 years ago now. And at that time, back in 2006, Ireland was starting off a study on generic ageing called TILDA. And that study really was interested in looking at what were the key determinants of health and well-being for people as they grow old. We didn't have a study of this nature looking at issues for people with an intellectual disability as they also grow older.
So who is the study aimed at?
Well, the study is aimed at, well, of course, and critically, people with an intellectual disability and their carers and their families, because it's really important that they understand what is important with respect to maintaining good health and well-being as they grow older. But we also are aiming this study, of course, at policymakers. This is the first time that we really will have good data to ensure that we have evidence-based policy making. So the findings that we will have here will be important for government, for people involved in perhaps in the HSE, for service providers.
And how do you think I might find more about the lives of people with intellectual disabilities?
As I always say, there's nothing as good as going out and asking the experts themselves, and that is people with an intellectual disability who are aging.
I decided to take May's advice, and so I set off to join up with the group of service users at Pospafingal Day Centre in Skerries. The day started off with a spot of gardening, and afterwards I had a little chat with Jasmine Russell to ask her why she thinks gardening is such a good pastime.
So Jasmine, so thank you for today.
For older people with intellectual disabilities, it would be a good pastime.
Absolutely. Because it's very relaxing and it's nice to be with your friends or with, you know, other people, you know, that you might be planting with, and there's a, you know, there's good camaraderie there. And
so what are the benefits from today?
As you saw yourself today, yeah. The group that we were working with,
yeah, like, it was great, wasn't it?
It was absolutely brilliant, and it's so therapeutic.
Yeah.
It's lovely,
yeah,
being out in the elements. There's so many studies have been done about like sensory gardens, for example, for people with dementia, and how they can stimulate memory. And there's the physical benefits, which are fantastic for older adults. It's very gentle. There's raised beds that you can use that have easy access. So it's certainly something that an older adult can get involved in.
It's nice to get down and dirty in the
Absolutely, that's exactly it. And that's sometimes that's missing in our lives, to be out in nature and to get your hands dirty.
Yeah. I think you have me turned.
I think you're going to be gardening from now on.
I
definitely think you got the gardening bug today,
I
didn't
think
you?
So. Who would have thought that gardening could be so beneficial? In fact, research has shown that gardening is good for mental health, can increase social connectedness, and also count as a form of exercise. These are all things that the IDS-TILDA study has highlighted as potential problems for older adults with intellectual disabilities. It was a bit chilly out there in the tunnel, so I'm heading back inside. Time to try my hand at some chair yoga. Wish me luck.
Hello, how's it going? Would you like to join us?
Yeah,
great. Sit down there. We've just started, so we're doing some belly breathing.
Oh.
So Claire, that was a great class. I really enjoyed it. So what are the benefits to yoga?
So basically what it's all about is connecting your body and your mind together. So it helps you release tension physically in the body, and it also helps your mind to just slow down and just come into the moment and relax.
So how did you develop the idea of chair yoga?
Chair yoga has been around for a while, and one of the great things about yoga is that it can be adapted and modified for anybody who's at any level of mobility or physical ability. So chair yoga is great for older people in the sense that they might not be able to move around as much, but they can safely access still so many of the yoga poses.
Do you think that the benefits can help older people with disabilities in terms of their joints and circulation?
Absolutely, yeah. There's a lot of research now into yoga and how it can have a lot of beneficial effects for the joints, for things like osteoarthritis or even osteoporosis as well, in helping to prevent these things as we get older, but also if you already have them. The evidence is there, just by keeping the joints mobile and keeping the blood flowing to the joints and helping to strengthen the muscles around the joints as well. We find that like the pain levels can be decreased. Mm. People can have a better mobility, they're less stiff.
What about digestion and constipation?
There are particular poses that are known to help with digestion. Twists in general, when we're twisting the body, it gives a massage to the internal organs. It increases the blood flow to those organs. It helps things flow along a little better, you know. It overall has many benefits.
And do you think it can relieve stress and anxiety?
Yes, I do. And particularly as we get older, there's so many things in our lives that can create more and more stress, both physically and mentally. And yoga can really, really help alleviate that. You're so busy in a yoga class focusing on your breath. It helps you to release and let go of all the other thoughts that are going around in your head. It's amazing how much better you can feel, and those effects can be quite long lasting as well.
And finally, do you think yoga can help you sleep better?
Oh yeah, definitely. The breathing techniques that you learn, and it really teaches you how to switch off, and it gives you techniques that you can use in bed if you're finding it hard to switch off. And then just in a general way, because it's relieving stress and anxiety in general, many people find that their sleep improves.
Well, I really enjoyed our chat today. Thank you so much. Wow, that was great. Yoga seems to be really helpful for a whole range of things. Studies have shown that yoga increases bone density, which is important because the IDS-TILDA study has reported very high levels of osteoporosis. Yoga can build core strength and balance, which may help us to avoid falling. And with up to 27% of participants reporting falls and 12.5% reporting injurious falls. Those were, for example, a bone is broken. This is very important. So I had a fantastic day, guys.
How about this appointment?
Oh, I totally forgot. How am I meant to get there?
Don't be worried, somehow I'll get you there.
I arrived safe and sound at the Dublin Dental University Hospital,
hey,
where I met with Kev the dentist, who specialises in treating people with intellectual disabilities.
Everybody feels a little bit nervous at the dentist, so it's okay to feel like that.
Yeah.
My name is Kev, and I'm one of the dentists here. Do you brush your teeth?
I do.
Okay, well that's great, that's great. We recommend twice a day. Did you know that I'm doing some research on tooth brushing for people with disabilities at the moment? What we found is that people with disabilities often get help brushing their teeth. And that makes a lot of sense, because sometimes the tooth brushing for people with disabilities isn't that good. If you have an intellectual disability in Ireland, you're twice as likely to lose all of your teeth. And what's even worse is that when people with intellectual disability lose all their teeth, they're 12 times less likely to get dentures. That means that they become orally disabled. They find it difficult to eat and they're more likely to have chronic constipation. With the IDS-TILDA study, we're finding out that people with intellectual disabilities, they actually go to the dentist way more often when they're older than people who don't have intellectual disabilities. The people with the worst outcomes are using services more. IDS-TILDA also shows us that people with intellectual disabilities either brush their teeth with no help, a little help, or a lot of help. We are developing videos to help people with intellectual disabilities teach everybody how to brush their teeth.
That's a great idea.
It is a great idea. It is really important to go to the dentist so that we can identify problems early and help prevent disease rather than treat disease. So I've got a little mirror here.
Okay.
And I'm going to use this to count your teeth. Is that okay if I do that? Right, I'm going to count your teeth now. Oh, wow. You've got lovely, lovely teeth. I'm going to show you how to brush your teeth on this. What you do is you put your toothbrush half on the tooth, half on the gum, at an angle of 45 degrees. Then you go forward and back with small strokes. And then do that for about 2 seconds. Forward two teeth, forward two teeth, forward two teeth. So you actually kind of brush your gum rather than your tooth.
So what are the main things I should be focused on when I go home today?
There's three things that you can do to keep your mouth healthy. The first is to make sure that you brush your teeth twice a day. Second is to make sure that you don't have frequent intake of sugary drinks and sugary snacks. And third is to make sure that you stay in touch with your dentist. And if you haven't been to the dentist recently, make an appointment. Thanks a million for coming in today. I'm so happy with your teeth. I'm going to see you again in a year's time. So thanks very much for today.
Thank you so much. What relief. All that brushing paid off. When you consider that 29% of participants had no teeth and that 68% of those with no teeth did not have dentures, it is clear that there needs to be a complete overhaul of how we approach dental health in people with intellectual disabilities. After all that, it's time for a bit of fun. So I headed off to Stewart's to meet up with Eric Lacey.
Hi, Mei Lin, is it?
Yes.
Hi, Eric's my name.
Okay.
Nice to meet you. Okay, so I believe we're going to do a dance class together.
Yes,
yeah?
Yeah.
Inside?
Yeah, sure.
Great, let's go.
The devil in my dreams, dancing in front of me, made me want to believe.
Did you enjoy that?
Yeah, that was fun.
Was that your first time doing a dance class?
Not my first time, no.
No? Yeah, I could see that. You had some pretty good moves there. Mm-hmm. So, why do you think it's a good idea to do dance classes?
It's good to keep the weight off. It's fun.
Yeah, it is.
I love the atmosphere.
Yeah, the atmosphere is great.
Yeah,
isn't
the
it?
Energy. I yeah. crave the energy. That's yeah. what it is. So, what are the benefits of dance?
Well, for me, the benefits of dance are first and foremost, fun. I really enjoy myself. I think it's a really good high energy situation. Did you find that in
yeah,
the
I found that, yeah.
Yeah.
That's true in the energy.
Yeah, and big smiles on everyone's faces. On top of that, we have the fact that it's really good for you physically in terms of your fitness and your mental well-being. One of the more interesting findings for me from the IDS-TILDA study is that essentially our waists are increasing. Now that's in the general population as well, but the people within IDS-TILDA, almost 80% of them would be considered overweight. The majority of those people consider themselves to be actually the right weight, but they're not taking the necessary precautions or steps to reduce their weight because they're not aware of it. Mm. Then you're leaving yourself open to the risk of diabetes, to chronic heart disease, to stroke. The number of chronic conditions that people have has actually increased. Brittle bones, osteoporosis, And again, from the IDS-TILDA study, we know that quite a lot of older people visit the emergency room, and quite a lot of that is for broken bones and fractures.
I was a little bit shocked to find out that 80% of IDS-TILDA participants were overweight or obese, while at the same time, 64% thought they were just the right weight. The number of chronic health conditions is also on the rise. The message seems to be clear. We need to exercise more. So whether it is the gym, dancing, walking, or any other physical activities that you enjoy, we must do more to turn this around. So get up and get fit. Until now, there have been very few dementia services available in Ireland. Next, I'm going to chat with Evelyn O'Reilly, who is a consultant nurse specialising in dementia. I want to understand what is now a major problem for both the general population and those with an intellectual disability.
Ah, Mei Lin, how are you? Lovely to meet you.
Nice to meet
You're
you.
Very welcome. Would you like to take a seat here?
Yeah, of course.
Great. So I am a clinical nurse specialist in dementia, with a particular interest in people with Down syndrome.
So what is the difference between dementia and Alzheimer's in people with Down syndrome?
So dementia is an umbrella term that describes many diseases of the brain, but the most common type of dementia that we see is Alzheimer's type dementia. More common ones would be vascular type dementia, frontal lobe type dementia. But for today, we're going to mostly focus on Alzheimer's type dementia.
So what are the risk factors to having dementia?
Okay, for people with Down syndrome?
People with Down syndrome, yeah.
Right. Most people with Down syndrome have what we call trisomy 21.
That.
You're familiar with that?
I have that.
The protein that's responsible for Alzheimer's disease, it's called amyloid protein, is produced on chromosome 21. People with Down syndrome have a triple copy of chromosome 21, so they are producing too much of this protein.
What other symptoms should I be looking out for?
Key things that we do look out for would be changes in personality, changes in mood. People may become very emotional, crying a lot for no apparent reason. And this is very important to check out because perhaps they're just depressed. There may be changes in their ability to find their way from their home perhaps to their workplace. Mm-hmm. They may take the wrong bus. There may be changes in sleep pattern. So the key behavioural changes are decline in functional ability. Somebody's ability to dress themselves. Their ability to feed themselves. Maybe their mobility may be affected. So all of these are key things that we need to look out for.
So I'm turning 30 in a few months and I want to know what I can do.
Yeah, really good question, Mei Lin. What I would recommend is that all people over the age of 35 with Down syndrome should have annual screening for dementia. I then have very good baseline evidence which I can measure over time to make sure that people are doing well. If we feel then that the person meets what we call criteria for dementia, we will then put a plan of action in place for that person so that their future care needs are met well.
That wasn't an easy conversation. Evelyn was really nice and explained things in a way that I could understand. I wanted to dig a little deeper into the area of dementia and brain health. So I headed back to Trinity to talk with Professor McCarron.
Most important thing is that people are afforded diagnosis, and timely and early diagnosis so that they can benefit from the treatments which are available for dementia. And the second thing, of course, is that we look at the whole area of prevention, and this is really important. We're very lucky now at Trinity to have the Global Brain Health Institute, and one of the IDS-TILDA team, Dr. Eamon McGlinchey, is focusing now on a whole area of research, particularly looking at younger people with Down syndrome in terms of prevention. And of course, there's a number of really critical things that people with Down syndrome should be doing now. And we know that there are things that are really important for our brain and our health, and that is things like exercise, regular exercise, a healthy diet, limiting the amount of alcohol. And also, of course, we know that one of the key issues for brain health is around lifelong learning, keeping our brain active, keeping ourselves mentally stimulated, having social connections and family and friends. So it's not just about adding years to life, but it is really about adding life to years.
Well, my journey has come to an end. I really had a wonderful time and I met lots of interesting people. Thank you for joining me on my journey. Hopefully it will inspire you to get up and get active and take more control of your life. Talk to your family, your friends, your key worker to see what changes you can make, so that hopefully we can all grow older together in a happy way, in a healthier way.
So who's heard this karaoke?
Yeah.
Shall we give it a go?
Yeah.